And now I want to turn it over to Christy Billinger, Associate Vice President and Executive Director of SRS.
Okay, with that, I'm going to introduce the leadership team at SRS. We have Julie Bishop, Associate Executive Director here at SRS, Dr. Jim Joyce, also Associate Executive Director, and then joining us via Zoom is Chrissy Strada, also Associate Executive Director here at SRS. So when David asked us to present, it was on the heels of presenting at the Council of Principal Investigators. We presented there as a result of a survey that the Council of Principal Investigators did. And it was a lot of the metrics that we do for our organization, as well as addressing some of the comments in the survey that the CPI conducted. So we are wanting to share our metrics as well as some of the results to the survey, some of the answers that we gave to the questions or concerns presented to us in the survey. And when David first came and asked if we would like to do the answers for you this month, I was thinking about changing the presentation. And then I thought it's probably a good idea for everyone participating to understand why we sometimes do the things we do. And so we pretty much left the presentation intact as we did with the CPI, so that you all will sometimes, so that you all may have some insight, or as David said, we'll go some transparency into what drives why we sometimes do the things we do. So today we're going to do a quick overview of SRS. I think most of you joining us today already know the reporting structure and the services, so we'll just kind of hit those at a high level. We'll cover the metrics. We'll cover some of the questions and responses to the CPI survey. And as David talked about, we'll leave time at the end of the presentation for questions. It's a pretty quick presentation, so I think we'll have plenty of time for questions. So this is the org chart for SRS. We report to the Vice President for Research, Dr. Jack Waldoff. We have three AEDs, so you'll see on the diagram here, Chrissy, Julie, and Jim. Under each of them, they have a little bit different slice of the pie. So Chrissy on the left side, she and her team serve TAMU, TAMU Tees, and the Doha campus, the TAMU-Q. And underneath her team, underneath her umbrella on her team, you'll see we have David there, and then she has pre-award and post-award. And so you can just take a look at that to see the folks on her team in a little bit more detail. And if we just slip over to Julie, she also has a similar look for AgriLife, HSC, TTI, System, and the regionals. Again, has pre-award, post-award, a little bit different look here with the asset team. We'll talk about them a little bit more. Actually, we'll talk about all these areas in a little bit more detail here in a few minutes, and the sponsored billing team. And then under Jim takes care of the IODP contracts and quality assurance. He has also research reporting as part of that team. And then to the far right, you'll see Maestro also reports to SRS. This is just a quick snapshot of the organization. Same look of the things in the organization, just a little cleaner look of the different functional areas in the organization, the different services that we provide in SRS. Okay, proposal metrics. So here you'll be able to see that the number of proposals that we are submitting annually has been going up. We had a little bit of a dip in 22, but they've been going up in 23. And if we follow the trajectory for 24, we're set to submit about 5,900 proposals. I'm going to show you another look at that. This will show you all of the members that we submit proposals for. And one of the reasons that our number for FY24 is increasing is because we did pick up a few members that we're submitting proposals for. Prairie View is on this list now. You'll see them. Looks like we've got about 183 so far for 24. We also picked up San Antonio and West Texas. So that also contributes to the idea that the numbers are going up, but our team is very busy submitting proposals. One of the things that we got feedback in the CPI survey on is that our proposal folks seem very busy. And I think that's just true in general. But one of the things that we asked in the survey is how many people are familiar with the proposal submission guidelines? And pleasantly surprisingly, most people who responded to the survey were familiar with the proposal submission guidelines. Unfortunately, that doesn't mean that everybody follows the proposal submission guidelines. So on this diagram, you can see that if you follow the key, the green is good, so 5 days or more. So this is the lead times for the proposals. And then as you get towards the burnt orange, that becomes bad. And I said before, I think somebody had a sense of humor when they made the burnt orange bad. So I think, you know, in light of the recent baseball events, that this is maybe even more true. So if you look at this, our team is stretched a little bit thin because we're getting a lot of proposals on the last day. Everything in the, starting with the light orange to the burnt orange, those are on the last day. And so that does mean that our team is working very hard on the last day to get the proposals assembled and submitted. That does not allow us to provide the best service to the investigators and give the most value to the proposal. It just doesn't give us much time to do all of the things that we'd like to be doing for the proposal. And here's some of those things. Submitting the proposals with the lead time allows us to make sure that we are compliant with the sponsor guidelines, as well as the system members, and to make sure that we can get the proposals through quality check. It's really disheartening for the investigators and all of the team, including the SRS team, if we get a proposal submitted but didn't have time to get it through QC and it gets rejected because of some error, it was not compliant with the RFP. So we really like to make sure that we get proposals through QC when and if possible. Our goal is to reduce the administrative burden at the proposal stage. We really like to work on the administrative pieces of the proposal so that the investigators can focus on the science. We feel like that's where most of the value is that we can add as SRS and really where the investigators need to be focusing their time. So together, making a team to submit the best proposal possible. We were asked why we have proposal submission deadlines. And when we looked at the other top 20 NSF HERB-ranked institutions, they all have proposal submission deadlines. Most of them, in fact, were more stringent than the guidelines that we have. I've already talked a little bit about the QC and the importance of the QC. And again, our team has a lot of knowledge and a lot of experience. And so we really want the opportunity to work on the proposal, get it with enough lead time so that we can really contribute to that proposal submission. I would encourage everyone to go out onto the SRS website. We do have the proposal submission guidelines posted there under the proposal section, and it does define what pieces are administrative, and that will help you understand the slide about the lead times. So we're going to move on now to the award and account setup expediting team. One of the things that we used to hear probably 8 years ago before we came to the organization or as we were coming to SRS is that PIs were waiting for long periods of time to get their awards set up. And so we looked at that and thought, how do we help solve that problem? Because if you look on this chart, you see that that's a lot of setup activity. Our investigators are busy, they're very successful. And so what was happening is that our post-award team was handling all of the post-award activities, as well as deadlines with sponsors and trying to get incoming awards set up in a timely fashion. This led to being stretched too thin. I think it led to some data integrity issues, which is really important when we talk about reporting for our system members. And so when we looked at this, we said, how do we make sure we do two things? We need to have good data integrity, and we need to have timely setups. And especially when you look at these numbers, I mean, that's a lot of work and that's a lot of setups. So we created the Award and Account Setup Expediting Team. This team has been really successful. Here's a snapshot of the setups that they did in the month of March for each member. And here is a snapshot. This is the thing that I like to share the most about the asset team. Here is the timeliness of the setups that they're getting accomplished. And so again, green is good in this case, orange is not as good. So 5 days or less is represented by the dark green. And I did just this morning get some updated information on this. So for May, 5 days or less, we're getting 73% of incoming awards set up in 5 days or less. That's phenomenal. 6 days to 10 days, that covers 81%. And 11 to 15 days, 85%. So this team is really busy. They're getting awards set up so that investigators can get their spending done, get their projects underway, meet the deliverables of their the scope of work, make sure that they're meeting the sponsor requirements. So the team's really doing a great job. Okay, contracts. We have, again, you'll see that the number of contracts that we have been negotiating has been increasing every year. And if we continue on this trajectory for 24, we will have negotiated about 4,100 contracts at the end of 24. This team is a small team. Jim, there's 20, how many?
One.
21, negotiating a large number of contracts. So we are looking for ways to streamline the work that this team is doing. We are piloting some things within SRS to try to lighten the load of the negotiators, because we're always looking for quick turnaround on negotiations, which is difficult also because not the negotiation component is not always on our side. It involves other offices at TAMU, as well as engaging with the sponsor. And so all of those pieces do take some time in the negotiation process. So again, just making sure that on our side of that fence, that we're working as quickly as we can to get the negotiations done and set up. Here's a snapshot of the negotiations that we are doing by member. So again, a lot of negotiations going on, a lot of contracts agreements coming in for our members. These numbers for every unit represent a lot of work. SRS ensures the outcome of the negotiation to provide the most favorable terms and conditions for the member. We try to make sure that we minimize the risk. We are trying to balance that being risk adverse as well as looking at the project and making sure that we can accept some risk while also giving the researcher the most flexibility to conduct the research. It is important for the negotiators to get all of this right up front, because that sets the stage for the life of the project. So very important component of the life cycle of an award. Here is a snapshot of the number of projects managed by our post-award team. So as of March 31st, we had 4,868 active projects being managed in post-award. Again, we are a billion-dollar research institution at TAMIS, and so that is a lot of work represented in those numbers. We try to facilitate research by providing oversight, making sure that we are monitoring all of the compliances, the expenditures, checking for allowability, allocability, and reasonableness. When it comes to audit findings and things that get universities in the news in a not positive way, it's in post-award. And so our post-award team works very hard to make sure that we manage projects properly, that expenditures are being done as correctly as possible, while also trying to make sure that we facilitate the research and get to the answer of yes, when and where we can. A lot of compliance going on. In the last 10 years, I'm going to say, compliances have really ramped up across the federal agencies. And so it really does touch about every aspect of research administration, but post-award probably sees it the most. One of the other things that we received comment on in the CPI survey is employee retention. And while it is true during during COVID, everything was pretty stable. Everyone was kind of staying put. And then after COVID, Tama said, all A&M employees come back to the office, and other universities did not take that approach. And so what was happening is that other universities were posting on a listserv that they had remote or hybrid opportunities. And so our staff would accept a job at an East Coast or West Coast school at those salary levels while sitting here in Bryan College Station area. And so we were able to work with the DPR and eventually the Board of Regents blessed that we could offer hybrid work or remote work in some cases. And that in conjunction with a market study, because one of the things alone wouldn't have helped us with our employee retention, but we were also able to do a market study with Class and Comp to offer competitive salaries that were, we were compared to other research institutions across the US, not just in Texas, because all of a sudden our competition was all across the US. And so with those two things in place, our turnover in FY23 was about 5.15%, and the TAMU turnover was 11.42. So those efforts really paid off for the SRS staff. The CPI also talked about they would like to have more communication from SRS, and that's a great thing. We're always happy to communicate. We like to have outreach, and this is where David has been instrumental. In the CPI newsletter, we almost always have information in that newsletter, whether it's what the federal agency is doing, what's happening at TAMU, what's happening at SRS, whatever important information needs to be shared on a research administration front, David gets that information to the CPI newsletter, a lot of times with input from other folks at SRS. So we always want to make sure that we are sharing news with the CPI. We also have a listserv. If there's anyone, so I'm guessing most of you on this Zoom are on that listserv, but if you have friends that are not, please let them know about our listserv. We sometimes reach out through that listserv to share important information. We are respectful. We don't use that listserv to send out lots of emails. We all get plenty of emails in a day. But if there's anyone who you would think would benefit from being on such a listserv, please let them know that it exists. We also have a robust website. There are lots of good resources on the SRS website. Here's just a sample of some of the things that's on the SRS website. All of the answers for you are archived on the website, as well as the answers for you express. Maybe someone would like to see information that's on the some of the videos that's on the website, but they don't have an hour to go watch a full answers for you. There's answers for you express. Those are short videos, usually 5 minutes or less. and there's certain things on how to do a certain task. Really good information there. CRA review, David also leads those. Even if you or some of your colleagues are not ready to set for the CRA test, or you have no interest in setting for the CRA test, there's still a lot of good information shared in those sessions. So I encourage you to attend those as well. But take some time and go out and just explore the website. Lots of good information and resources available there. So when it came to contract negotiations, we got some feedback in the survey that we couldn't quite tell what it was aimed at. And we feel like there might have been some confusion about what offices are negotiating what agreements. And so we wanted to share this information because there's multiple contracting offices across campus. These are the ones that the investigators and the research community most likely are having interaction with for research contracts. And so we just wanted to share this and provide this as a resource because, for instance, let me just pick one of these out. So if AgriLife Industry, if an investigator has a question or wants to talk about industry on an AgriLife project or a AgriLife proposal, that's going to be a contract that's negotiated through the AgriLife office. So this is just good information because this can be a little confusing, because I think when people think of a research contract, they immediately contact SRS, but that's not always the case. Sometimes it takes a little while, as we were talking about earlier, because our office is not the only one. When we're negotiating a contract, it takes several offices. Sometimes there are sticky agreements that sticky terms that take a little while to work our way through with a sponsor. And so one way that we can help an investigator go ahead and get their project underway is if the following conditions are met, the ones down below, we can go ahead and do interim funding for the investigators. So the investigators can go ahead and start the project, but the following conditions do have to be met before we can set the project up for interim funding. We typically look for this when an agreement comes in. If we can do this automatically, if those conditions are met, we'll go ahead and offer this and try to get this set up. It may be that these are not all in place when the agreement hits our door. Maybe there's a compliance item that is still being worked on with the investigator in the compliance office. And so when it hits our door, we can't set it up for interim funding. But maybe that compliance item gets worked out while we're still in the negotiation process. And if that's the case, please reach out to us. Let us know that that's happened. Bring that to our attention. We'll revisit that. And if we can set you up for interim funding, we're happy to do that. The SRS staff workload. So we have some really nice dashboards at SRS. We worked with Maestro to create dashboards for each of our functional areas, so that we can keep an eye on the workload of the staff, because the last thing we want to do is overload someone so that they feel overwhelmed, or that our customers are not getting responses or not getting work back in a timely manner. We do expect our staff to answer emails within 24 hours. There may be some peak times where that's not possible, and I immediately think of heavy proposal deadlines. At that time, it's really important for the proposals to get out the door and that we meet the sponsor deadlines. And so the staff may be really focused on those deadlines of getting the proposals put together. And any emails that's coming in that's maybe not related to those immediate deadlines or proposals, they may be put aside. But hopefully within that 24 hours, and if not 24 hours, definitely 48 hours, our team tries to get back to those emails. If there's ever a case where you're not getting a response from the team, please reach out to us. There may be some extenuating circumstances that we know about. We may need to help out our team member. There may be something going on internally that we need to know about, but we will certainly check into that. We want to make sure that everyone's getting responses and that our team is not overloaded. We continuously review our processes to check for efficiencies. We do process mapping within the organization to make sure that the things we do in the organization are adding value and that we're not just continuing to do things because it's what we've done for the last 5 years. We want to make sure that we only have so many resources like everyone else, so we want to make sure that we're maximizing those resources as well. And I talked a little bit about the federal requirements, how those have increased over the last several years. They're crazy at this point. So again, impacting about every unit on campus probably. So our leadership team, you'll be able to find our contact information listed at the URL below. If you ever have any questions or need to reach out to us for any reason, please feel free to do so. You will find that we're very responsive to your questions or needs or concerns. The other thing in the CPI survey, we got a couple of really good comments. Can SRS, well, we got lots of really good comments, but a couple that I'll call out. Can SRS services be evaluated at the time of service? We think that that is a great idea. And in fact, when you're getting emails from our team now, you probably see at the bottom of the email, there is a link where you can now go and complete a very short survey. It takes probably a minute or two, depending on how much you want to type into that survey. We are looking for timely feedback. It's really nice to have feedback at the time that we're providing the service so that if there is a concern, we can address the concern at that time. But if there's also good feedback, if someone's doing a really great job, and we got actually a few of these that we talked about just earlier this week, we also want to share that with our team. If they're doing a good job or going above and beyond, we want to be able to share those good kudos too. So that's now in play. You should see that on the bottom of all of our emails. The other comment, there's no budget management tool for any project management for PIs to use once the projects are awarded. There are probably a lot of shadow systems on campus that people are using that do not provide a lot of transparency. There's probably not even versioning on those. And so we have worked with Maestro over the last year to start a budget forecasting module. We did have to slow down on that just a little bit because we had to do some transitioning to the cloud, and then some other technology changes, but we are going to get that back underway soon, so that we can get that budget forecasting tool out to the departments and the investigators. It'll be very sophisticated. I'm very excited about that. I think that will be a great tool for people. I think it will be a game changer. The other thing was about Maestro training in the researcher portal and just Maestro training in general. So there are lots of good training for Maestro. Maestro has standing training. If you log into the Maestro in the SSO, you'll see their standing training dates, and they will also do on-demand training. They're very good. They're very responsive. They want to make sure that they're taking care of our end users. And so if you have a group that would like to be trained, reach out to our Maestro team. If you have an individual that would like to be trained, please reach out to our Maestro team. They're very good. It's a very powerful tool. There's a lot of information in there that people can have at their fingertips. And so we want to make sure that everyone knows how to use it so that you can get the most out of the tool. All right, that wraps up the presentation.